This is the first table saw that I bought 20 years ago, and here's the stand for it, and it has this wheelbase with retractable wheels, and I thought I'd make a video of unloading it into my big garage workshop, which is still quite disorganized. Those four ball bearings ride in inclined tracks, and that allows me to lift the saw off of its feet by shifting the base side to side with the lever. Now what? Ta-da! A few years ago, a friend gave me 10 of these boxes, and I didn't really have a use for them, but man, they've come in handy so many times since then. It does not line up. Now I'm mounting my tilting router lift, which takes the place of the right wing on the table saw. Notice how this is ground away a little bit? I've ground that away years ago so this part could come up a little bit further against the casting so I'd get a little bit more depth of cut. Now this saw is only a 9-inch saw, so I can only use 9-inch blades in it. I would test this saw right now, but it's rewired to 220 volts, and I don't have that kind of plug in here right now. But the motor connecting to the switch is still the old 110 volt plug because these plugs are much more expensive. And I can just plug the motor directly into 120 volts and that will derate this 1.5 horsepower motor to about a third of a horsepower. Takes it a while to get up to speed. It's now a few days later, and I installed a 240 volt receptacle by the breaker panel. And now, running off of that, the saw starts much better. And with the bottom enclosed, and the back mostly enclosed, it does a pretty decent job of keeping all the dust inside the saw. So that was filmed over a week ago, and I remember one question I've gotten quite often is about my homemade rip fence on this table saw. I bought the saw used, and the rip fence that was on it had been broken at some point. It was welded together so crooked it was unusable. So I made this fence, which just clamps onto this rod here. It clamps on using this part and this part here, and I just lock it by tightening these knobs. It's a little bit awkward that way, but it works. This part here was originally made out of wood, but at the time I still had access to the University of Waterloo student machine shop, so I milled this out of aluminum on a Bridgeport milling machine. If I was doing it again, I think I'd probably just make this part out of Baltic birch plywood instead. Because the precision actually doesn't come from the aluminum part. The reference surface is this part here, touching here and here, and that keeps it square. Another thing about this saw is that the table is actually not perfectly flat. If I put this piece of wood down,
you can see it rocks back and forth a bit because the middle of the table is a little bit higher. In fact, you can see the table is worn a little bit more right about here because that's the high spot. That flaw really bugged me when I discovered it 20 years ago, but it's actually made no difference because as I'm passing the piece of wood across, as long as I'm not pushing it down near either edge of the table, it always cuts the same depth. Whereas if the table was sagging in the middle, then of course it would make a major difference. So if anything, actually, this might be a slight advantage when dealing with slightly crooked wood.
I bought this saw in 1996 as a stopgap to keep me from buying something fancier because I was tight on money at the time. But the irony is, I did buy something fancier in 2007, but this saw actually cuts cleaner than my fancier saw.